Today is May 17th, 2023, and we are nearly at the anniversary of the Pacific Northwest's most destructive volcanic eruption in recorded history. As on May 18th of 1980, was once the almost perfect symmetrical stratovolcano of Mount St. Helens that towered to a height of 9,677 feet, in less than a minute exploded and collapsed in a powerful planning eruption, incinerating an area of 230 square miles or 600 square kilometers, depositing 2.5 cubic kilometers of landslide debris and dropping to a height of only 8,307 feet while leaving behind a large C-shaped collapse scar. Normally, this anniversary would cause the volcano to reappear in the news, and it has, but for a completely different reason. This is because around 8:45 p.m. local time on May 14th of 2023, a fairly sizable landslide occurred on a section of the Mount St. Helens volcanic complex. Traveling at a speed of 50 miles per hour, this landslide quickly moved more than 2,000 feet to the west, blocking a section of the Spirit Lake Highway and taking out a local bridge. This trapped a dozen people overnight who were eventually rescued by helicopter in addition to completely cutting off access to the Johnson Observatory, which I last visited in July of 2022. I have outlined where the landslide and mudslide seemingly originated alongside this section of road it took out. This landslide carved away at what I estimate to be a 392-foot wide, 578-foot long, and an up to 20-meter or 66-foot deep scar on the mountainside, transporting in mere moments a grand total of 195,000 cubic meters or 6.89 million cubic feet of rock and debris. As for the elephant in the room, this landslide was not caused by a change in volcanic activity at Mount St. Helens. However, since I drove on the exact road not long ago, I remember a few details of the regional topography that can help explain why the landslide occurred and provide additional insight. The first thing I want to note is that 1,500 feet to the east of where the mudslide originated is a patch of brightly colored brown, orange, and red ground that stands out from the surrounding white to gray colored rock. This patch represents significant hydrothermal alteration and staining caused by what are most likely a series of regional hot springs, which are acidic and leave iron staining compounds behind as it flows down the slope. While this is the only easily visible patch, it would not surprise me if other regional streams had similar alteration occurring within them due to traces of hot spring water. What I am trying to establish is that this very specific valley was already at a heightened risk of landslides occurring due to the hydrothermal alteration occurring within sections of it. Although this is by no means an extreme example of such, when you see highly altered rock on a volcano, it is almost a guarantee that a landslide or a series of landslides will eventually occur, with, for example, this slope of the Iliamna volcano in Alaska showing hydrothermal alteration. Second is the geology of the slope that failed. It was composed of thousands, if not tens of thousands of years worth of some of the most unstable and high-risk rock types in terms of landslide risk. Specifically, the slope that collapsed was composed of more than 50 feet thick of lahar deposits, aka older mudflows caused by volcanic processes, pyroclastic flow deposits, and ash. All three of these materials were, when combined, only loosely consolidated. Thus, since the area was covered in snow from an unusually wet winter, the weather played the actual trigger for this landslide. Whereas on May 7th, the high temperature in the region was 62 degrees Fahrenheit, on the day of the landslide, the high temperature was 93 degrees Fahrenheit, likely being an all-time high for that day of the year on Mount St. Helens as the region experienced a heat wave. This caused an increased amount of snow to melt and soak into the ground as water, thus further destabilizing the slope until there was no longer enough friction to maintain the hillside, causing it to collapse. In terms of the closure of Johnson Ridge, the road leading to it will likely remain closed, in my opinion, for weeks at a minimum. Thus, I recommend that if you want to get close to Mount St. Helens on the day of the eruption anniversary, instead visit the Windy Ridge site to the northeast of the volcano. Thanks for watching. If you would like to request a specific topic, please leave a comment below. Additionally, I would like to thank my new YouTube member, David Vollweiler, for supporting this channel.